example, let's say you have this beautiful tile and you want to send it to your friend, but there is a crazy painter on the street who arbitrarily paints this tile in some color, and what's received on the other end is this ugly tile. And what this is trying to do, we can formalize this by saying that we have a message M and we are going to send it over an adversarial channel which applies this tampering function F, and what's received on the other end is this tampered message M star, which is F of M. And in general, you can think of this tampering function F coming from a class of functions, script F. And you can think of, in our analogy, that this painter has a different buckets of different colors. Okay? So what can we do? So maybe we can try to put our tile in a box and then send it, and then hope that when the painter paints again, only the box is painted, and we can somehow remove the box and recover our nice looking tile as it is. So how do we do this? So now we are going to have a coding scheme. So we are going to take a message M, we are going to encode it to get a code word C, and we're going to send this code word C. And again, the channel is going to apply this tampering function F, and what is received is this C star, which is F applied on C. And then we are going to decode this C star to get some M data. And in general, so here I want to first highlight that we are in the coding scheme area, so there are no secrets. Encode and decode are completely public, they do not have any secrets at all. So in general, what do we expect from these schemes is that for tampering functions coming from certain classes, we want to guarantee that there is some nice relation between the decoded message and the original message. This is what we want to kind of gain from all these coding schemes. So what are some of the examples of these coding schemes? A very well-known example of coding schemes is this error correcting course, where the tampering function families that we consider are the functions which can modify at least, or like at max, half the code word symbols. And the desired property of the nice relation that we want is the decoded message is exactly identical to the original message. And this is the what we gain from this is the correctness. But now consider that we have another adversary who can potentially modify every single code word symbol. And obviously we cannot get correctness in this case. But what we can hope to get is something called as non-malleability. And the relation that we want to have here is that when we decode the tampered code word, what we are going to get is either the original message or something completely independent. And what I mean by independent here is that, let's say the attacker will not be able to tamper the code word in a way so that after decoding we get M plus 1 or like some function of M. We either get the message that we started with, or we get something completely unrelated to the message. That's what I mean by independent. And the desired property here is the tamper resilience, and I will talk more about this in a while. Okay, so let's see at some parallel. So non-malleable codes were introduced, as Shruti told earlier, by Jingoski, Pietzera, and Wicks in 2010. And in the original result, they also showed an impossibility result, where they said that we cannot achieve this kind of tamper resilience against every efficient function or every polynomial tampering function. And why is this true? Because we can have a simple attacker which decodes a message and then re-encodes M plus 1, and there is no way we can win against this adversary. So we have to somehow always have to restrict the tampering functions. And this line has been studied extensively in the split state model, as we have seen, and there has been a lot of work on how to restrict that error, how to get stronger split state models or improve the efficiency and rate of such constructions. Another natural way of restricting the attackers is by restricting the complexity of the tampering function. So this was studied by Faust et al. In 2014, where they considered the tampering functions which could be modeled as circuit families of some bounded size. Then in 2016, myself and the same set of authors, we considered the tampering functions which could be modeled as NC0 circuits. So NC0 circuits are constant depth circuits which have bounded family. So Then this work was, and then so there is this line of work which is now trying to understand how we can restrict the tampering functions in terms of the complexity of the tampering function. This work was further improved in 2017 by Chattopadhyay and team, where they gave non-malleable boards which were tamper resilient circuits, AC0 circuits. So these are constant depth circuits with unbounded fanning. However, this construction was inefficient in the sense that the code word length was not tolerable. In this work, we extend this line of work, wherein we show that how we can construct non-malleable codes against AC0 tampering functions, tampering functions which can be modeled as bounded depth decision trees and space-bounded streaming kind of stuff. And I will tell you what these three models mean in general. There have been certain other results which either introduce some different variants of non-malleable codes or certain weaker definitions or different models that I want you to talk about. So let's see. So our main result is that in this paper we provide a general framework for constructing non-malleable codes for different tampering classes for which certain average case hardness results are known. So we are trying to leverage from the complexity theory results to construct non-malleable codes. And in particular, we instantiate our framework to give the first known efficient constructions against these tampering values, LC0 tampering, bounded depth decision trees, and space-bounded streaming tampering. And these constructions also work for encoding multiple grids. So let's look at these families in detail. So first family that we are going to consider is this bounded depth circuits. So we specifically consider the circuits which have depth up to log n over log log n, where n is the size of the code word. And this obviously constrains the constant depth circuit. So we include, we get tamper resilient circuits, KC0 circuits. The hard problem which we are going to rely on is the problem of parity. So we are going to rely on the fact that parity or XOR cannot be computed using an AC0 circuit. And unfortunately, in certain places, we need certain more assumptions. And the assumptions that we need to get the tamper resilience in this case is that we need a CRS model, and we need a public key encryption scheme and simulations on NISIC with certain properties. This will be clear later on. Similarly, we also get tamper resilience against tampering functions, which can be modeled as bounded depth decision trees up to depth of n to the epsilon, where again n is the length of the code word. The hard problem that we need is again that of parity. Just one thing to notice is that this hard problem is information theoretic. There are no computational assumptions on this part, and we need the same computational assumptions for the bounded depth decision trees. However, another interesting case is that we consider a tampering model where the tampering function can be seen as a space-bounded streaming kind of array. So this can be seen as a tampering function which can be modeled as a branching program of a fixed width. So this kind of models that there are bounds on the space. And especially if the adversary has a space bound of n to the epsilon, then without any computational assumptions, just relying on the recent result by Raz in 2016, which shows that learning parity is hard even for these kind of algorithms, the streaming algorithms with space bound is hard, we get non-malleable codes. So now I'm going to talk about some preliminaries. I'll give an overview of construction. So here is some syntax. As I said, we are going to be in CRS model. So we are going to have a CRS gen algorithm which outputs a CRS. The encoding algorithm takes this CRS, that is a common reference, common random string or common reference string, and a message M and randomness for encoding and output a code word C. And the decoding algorithm is again going to take the CRS and the code word as input and output the message M. So here is a simpler definition of non-malleable codes. And this definition actually implies the definition. We actually achieve a much stronger definition than this, and that implies the previous definition, which was the standard non-malleable definition, which was discussed in the previous talk. So consider this experiment. So we have a challenger which generates the CRS and gives it to the attacker. The attacker chooses a tampering function f from this family. The challenger then encodes some message and generates the code word C. It is going to apply this tampering function and get this tampered code word. And then it is going to decode the tampered code word to obtain this M tilde. And the experiment outputs M tilde. And the security guarantee that we want is that the view of this experiment is indistinguishable for any two messages M0 and M1 for all tampering functions F in this tampering class. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about Non-malleable double encryption paradigm. So this is just a review of a technique which allows us to get non-malleability in terms of encryptions. So how does Non-malleable double encryption work? So we start with a CPA secure PK system. We generate two pairs of public and secret keys, and we also generate a CRS and a trapdoor for an SX system. So this is the key gen. We output the public keys and the CRS as the public key, and we output one of the secret keys as the secret key of the system. In order to encrypt a message, what we do is we encrypt a message using both public keys to get a ciphertext, and we generate an ISIC proof saying that the plain text underlying these two ciphertexts is same, and we output these two ciphertexts and a proof as the ciphertext. And finally, in order to decrypt, we basically verify if the proof is correct, and if the proof verifies, then we decrypt one of the ciphertexts with the secret key. So just to remind, this is a review of the encryption scheme. I'm still not talking about our construction because we do not have any secrets. So how does our construction go? So again, this is the double encryption. You have two ciphertexts. We have the algorithm has, the decryption algorithm has secret key corresponding to the first ciphertext, and we have an ISIC proof claiming the consistency of the two ciphertexts. In our scheme, we are going to replace this ciphertext that we had with a string. And how do we select this string? So remember that our tampering functions come from this class F, which has certain restrictions in terms of complexity. So there we are going to choose two distributions, D0 and D1, which are hard to distinguish for all these complexity classes. These distributions can be distinguished by a polynomial time algorithm, but for all the functions or the algorithms in class F, it is hard to distinguish them. And then in order to encrypt the BP, we are basically going to draw a string X from distribution D0 and D. And this is how we kind of go around the fact that we do not have any secrets and we do not need any secrets for coding. And we are going to have the second ciphertext as it is, and an ISIC proof claiming that this ciphertext and the string are consistent with each other. So as I said, from this point onwards, you can think of the tampering function family F as the AC0 functions. So we are in the CRS model, and these distributions D0 and D1 can be just thought of as random strings with parity 0 or 1. And again, because parity is hard to compute in AC0, so these distributions are hard. We are going to need a public encryption scheme with certain properties, and we are going to need simulation sound physics. One thing I want to note is that these public key encryption schemes and ISIC schemes are not required to be secure against the polynomial time tampering functions. And this is the reasons why, in some cases, we can get around these computational assumptions and actually get information theoretical. So let's see the proof scheme. So the double encryption, the Non-malleable proof, we first start with the ciphertext and replace the proof with a simulated proof. We are going to do exactly same thing. In the next step, we replace the ciphertext, which is never being decrypted in the real world, with a random value. We are also going to replace the ciphertext with a random value. Next step in the Non-malleable scheme, the decryption oracle changes the secret key. And remember, we do not have any secrets. So this is the crucial step in the proof, where we need to introduce an alternate decoding algorithm which allows us to switch from the real decoding to the alternate decoding. And I'm not going to give details for this, but you can check the paper for this. And this is the step that is like technically challenging. And the final step, we are going to switch the hard distribution where we switch the remaining cybernetics. And why does this proof work? So in order to show that this proof works, we need to show that we can compute parity using AC0 circuit. So how do we go about this? So basically, the proof strategy which I just showed you, when instantiated with the appropriate ingredients, ensures that the entire tampering experiment I showed in the definition can be simulated in a tampering class, AC0 in this case. And what this means is that if the output changes when we start the encoding of 0 instead of encoding of 1, then we basically have an AC0 adversary who can distinguish between encoding of 0 and 1. This specifically means that we can distinguish between D0 and D1 using an AC0 circuit, and that means we can compute parity because these distributions are exactly parity-based, and that's the modernization. So now I'm just going to talk briefly about how this can be seen as a generic framework to construct non-malleable codes. So remember the properties that we needed for the hybrid. We needed the simulation of proofs, we needed semantic security, and so on. So the properties that we need are like this. So given that we have these two hard distributions for the tampering class and public key encryption scheme with the decryption in the tampering class and an ASIC scheme with verification in F, if we have simulation of proofs, I just wanted to note that this is a slightly weaker notion of simulation, wherein we only need the guarantee against the tampering class instead of the polynomial time attackers, and we can actually give the randomness of the verifier. If we have simulation of encryption, which is semantic security against the tampering class, if we have the simulation soundness, and we have this property that we call as hardness of alternate decoding, which means that when we switch from the real decoding to the alternate decoding, the distributions are still hard to distinguish for the tampering class, then we get non-malleable codes against the tampering class F. And this framework can be used also in the encoding multiple bits with slight more strengthening. So the first three conditions remain exactly the same. We only need to strengthen or boost the last condition, wherein now that we want to ensure that the alternate decoding algorithm decode prime, when composed with any function f, any Boolean function f, which takes m inputs, still cannot distinguish between the hard distributions D0 and D1, where m is the number of input bits that we want. So just to summarize, the whole idea behind the framework is that given a tampering class f and some polynomial time function g, if we know that for all functions in this class f, and the f and g have low correlation, then we can potentially construct non-malleable codes against this class f. And how we are going to do it is basically we are going to construct this distribution db as the distributions over inputs x such that gx is equal to b for 0 and 1. And if these D0 and D1 are easy to sample, and we have other computational assumptions, as I said, then we get efficient non-malleable. So to summarize, we give a framework for constructing non-malleable codes from certain average case hardness results in complexity theory. And we specifically instantiate it against these classes of tampering functions. And some of the important interesting questions is that, can we have more such instantiations of our framework? Can we get rid of the computational assumptions as we could do it for the space-bounded streaming tampering functions? Or if we can get results in the non-CRS model, or even whether we can explore more interesting connections with the complexity theory where we can benefit from the advancements in that field. Thank you very much.
Questions?
Can you say that
of yourself for the mic, please?
OK. Can you say one or two sentences about how you instantiate your simulation sound, I think? In particular, you usually...
So for AC0, it's pretty simple because we just compute the tableau of the very first computation, and it's a constant depth circuit, so it's a, you get verification in AC0.
I mean, when like, what is it? So you construct the simulation from scratch.
Sorry, I didn't
know. How do you instantiate the simulation sound anything? Which anything protocol do you use?
We use the result by Sahai and Groth again. Yeah, like the standard DISC, we just basically compute the, well, like there is nothing fancy in the DISC. We just use the standard available construction and compute the tableau so that the decoding can be done. Verification.
So when you remind the hardness of parity, the average case hardness of parity, are you reminding us as a black box, or do you need to plug in to the proof of hardness?
No, we use it as a black box. We just assume that it's hard to compute parity with zero, and that's all we need. Because we basically just need to kind of show we have to have this hard distribution from the hard problem. And as I said, we just select random strings with parity 0 or parity 1 to encode 0 or 1.
Okay. Any other questions? Last chance in this conference? Okay. Thank you.